All right, well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the U.S. Pavilion. We're thrilled to have you here with us today. The U.S. Pavilion here at the World Conservation Congress is a U.S. Department of State public diplomacy initiative based out of Washington, D.C., and we're really thrilled to have you. It's my pleasure to introduce the first big program of the day, which is called Linking Cultural and Natural Heritage for Better Conservation Outcomes. We have a wonderful panel of speakers, and I'm going to go ahead and introduce them and their affiliation, and then invite the first speaker to the podium. So we have Jonathan Putnam, who will be our moderator for the question and answer, and he is an International Park Affairs Specialist at the National Park Service. We have Dr. Mechtild Rossler, who is the Director of the Heritage Division and the World Heritage Center. Glad to have you here with us today. Andrew Potts is an expert in cultural heritage historic preservation law. Kalani Quiocho is the Native Hawaiian Program Specialist for the Papahānaumokuākea Marine National Monument. I've been practicing. That was good, right? We have Atuatasi Lelei Peau, who is the Deputy Superintendent of the National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa. And last but not least, we have Poky, Tane, Haoa, who is the Commissioner for the Development of Easter Island. Thanks everyone for being here, and I'll invite Dr. Mechtild Rossler to the stage.
Thank you very much. Can we have the slides? Oh, it works. So for me, it's a great pleasure to speak here at the U.S. Pavilion. Because the U.S. was actually instrumental in getting the World Heritage Convention going with, in 1965, the White House Conference. And I personally also organized the 1992 Santa Fe World Heritage Committee, where we celebrated 20 years of the World Heritage Convention. Now, do I move this forward this way? Yes. The World Heritage Convention is quite unique in bringing together nature and culture, and you see up to here six, this is culture, and then these are the natural heritage. We have these 10 criteria for World Heritage listing, and the nature culture journey at this Congress documents that we had some challenges in bringing nature and culture closer together within the convention implementation. And we made some progress with cultural landscapes, a great number of mixed sites in recent years, but wherever you go actually to the World Heritage Site, you find that the site management has to deal with nature and culture in an integrated way. And we need to learn from each other. And we have also moved into setting global standards with the World Heritage Convention. And I personally believe that that is the beauty of World Heritage. Today we have 192 state parties, so we are very close to being totally universal, and more than 1,000 sites, 1,052 since the Istanbul meeting this year. And this is also a global network for monitoring the state of conservation and for learning and education sites and sharing experiences from the local to the national to the international level. Being in Hawaii here, I also would like to highlight the marine sites and the small islands, critical for the survival of our planet and the people. And I think the Pacific voyage here as the Congress, it's also a demonstration of the creativity of the people and their survival in fragile environments. I would also like to highlight our very latest publication on the high seas. This was actually a request from the UNESCO auditors to come up looking at the outstanding universal value beyond national territories. And as this convention is about outstanding universal value, yes, this got a lot of attention. We are looking into OUV in the Sargasso Sea, and I saw it at other presentations here, the lost city there. Linking nature and culture was always a topic. We tried very hard to bring people and the environment together, closer together in the daily operations of the World Heritage Convention. And I think we have made some progress. Also with a connecting praxis project, which our partners, IUCN, ICOMOS, and ICROM are carrying out. And some of you have seen other sessions here at this Congress. At the same time, we also looked at linkages between the tangible and the intangible heritage, looking into the landscape and the seascape and moving forward to better sharing benefits from World Heritage. Because you can imagine World Heritage is a huge industry behind, so it's not only in terms of economy, but also in terms of human rights, indigenous peoples, and gender. With the intentional destruction of heritage in many places in the world, especially in the Arab region, and I can talk about it because I've been personally recently to Palmyra to look at the destruction, we need to build on the pride for places to protect this heritage for the future. And this is probably one of the biggest challenges of protecting world heritage in the 21st century. I also think that world heritage is so unique as it links the past with the future and the present. And it's so important for the identity of people. It's actually the first convention in the world which put intergenerational equity to the forefront before the word of sustainable development existed. I would also like to highlight the Sustainable Tourism Program, and I invite colleagues to meet with my colleague Peter De Bruyne from the Tourism Program to learn more about the tools we put at your disposal to make these sites better experiences for visitors and more benefits for local communities and peoples. And of course, World Heritage, and I just come from another session on the Sustainable Development Goals. Of course, World Heritage is part of the SDGs. Goal 11.4 is specifically. And I think this is key in the implementation in many ways, from the environment to cultural policy, from gender to human rights and intergenerational equity. Youth is a critical point in World Heritage and in our journey to make the World Heritage places and transmit them to future generations. And finally, I would like to invite you to take a copy of the World Heritage Review at this Congress. We made a special issue for the Congress, which looks at critical conservation issues. And we actually count on you all to make World Heritage better places for the future and for the conservation of this world. Thank you very much.
So in a moment, you're going to hear some amazing presentations about the innovative work being done at some of the most beautiful and special places in the world. But first, you're going to hear a talk on law and policy. I feel a little bit like this is making you eat your spinach before you get the dessert. But the point of my brief presentation is to suggest that there are existential, global, critical issues happening, and that the solutions and the innovations that you're going to hear about at these sites really are highly relevant to solving problems at a global scale. And so I want to set this policy context so you can see how urgent and relevant the work being done at these sites is on a global scale. So I do this. So maybe you know that the world, the United Nations, civil society, sectors of international community have been going through a multi-year process of setting new 15-year development goals for the planet, called originally the Post-2015 Development Agenda and now Agenda 2030. It's the most holistic, far-reaching effort the international community has ever undertaken to agree on a common vision of sustainable development for the planet. The effort has unfolded across the globe and throughout many sectors, but four of the most consequential undertakings are illustrated in this slide: the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, the UN Climate Change Conference in Paris, COP21, and the resulting Paris Agreement. The agreement expected to be issued next month in Quito, Ecuador, as part of the Habitat 3 Summit, a vision of sustainable and resilient cities and human settlements for the 21st century. And of course, the establishment of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, 17 goals that all the countries of the world have agreed to pursue for the next 15 years, hence Agenda 2030. And Dr. Rossler alluded to that already. The thing that is remarkable about all four of these processes is the very high level at which these processes have recognized the critical role of natural heritage and cultural heritage in human development. It's really unprecedented. No charters, no doctrines, no UN processes before now have ever recognized at this high level and this comprehensively the critical role that nature and culture play in human development. So it's really an inflection point. It's a special moment in time. And it's a validation of the work that many of you in this room have undertaken to make these arguments. I want to emphasize, though, that not only do many of these agreements recognize a role of nature and culture in development, sustainability, and resilience, but they expressly focus on the interlinkages of them, not the least of which is in Sustainable Development Goal 11.4, where all of the countries of the world agreed that the safeguarding of natural and cultural heritage is a key strategy for urban resilience and sustainability. So it's quite remarkable. At the same time, and Dr. Rossler alluded to this also, we have not necessarily found the right tools and the right approaches to fully acknowledge the interlinkages of nature and culture and to leverage the synergistic relationship of the two. And so we've been given this amazing assignment by the world to leverage and capitalize natural and cultural heritage for human sustainability, but yet confidentially amongst us, I think we can agree that we are still finding our way in terms of realizing that full potential. And so that is why at this Congress we have a nature culture journey. The idea of the journey is to bring together stakeholders in cultural natural heritage to really try to envision and imagine how we can fulfill this mandate. And that's why the presentations that you're about to hear are so important. I'm from the United States Committee of ICOMOS, and I can just say for my organization, one of our top of mind strategies is to navigate to sites, to places, to managers, to experts, to communities that are doing exemplary work in showing the way for the integration of nature and culture in service of biodiversity, sustainability, resilience, development, and to lift those up as examples, because many communities don't have those tools, they don't have those models. And so the lessons that we're going to hear next really need to leave those communities and they need to be shared globally. And so I know that each of these sites are doing that already, but we have to help them scale it up. These examples you're going to hear about really need to be shared at a global level, because this is some of the best work that's being done in the world, and that work is critical to the nature and culture sectors collectively discharging this awesome obligation that we have been given. And with that, I myself am anxious to get to dessert.
Aloha mai kākou. My name is Kalani Quiocho. I'm the Native Hawaiian Program Lead for Papahānaumokuākea Marine National Monument. Mahalo for having me. I said yesterday some of my responsibilities, which really include coordinating and implementing the strategies and activities related to Native Hawaiian cultural access, research, education, partnerships, and basically the overall integration of Native Hawaiian values and concepts into the daily management of the monument. And we do this through partnership. We do this with the Office of Hawaiian Affairs and also with engaging with the Native Hawaiian community and the cultural working group, which is convened by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. So I'm going to go over these four things, basically the cultural significance of Papahānaumokuākea, talk a little bit about the management framework, because that's very, very important as how we do these things within our management, and then Native Hawaiian engagement, and then the cultural integration of some of our work. So of course, let's begin with place. Papahānaumokuākea encompasses the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, which is three quarters of the Hawaiian archipelago, and includes high basalt islands and low-lying atolls, and of course the marine environment that surrounds. It stretches nearly 2,000 kilometers and straddles the Tropic of Cancer, also known in Hawaii as Ke Alapolahiva Kane, the black sacred glistening trail of Kane, the patron god of the sun. So it's believed in Hawaiian worldview that the archipelago is divided into two realms, basically Poau and Ao. Poau meaning darkness, night, and ao meaning daylight. And you can kind of conceptualize this by thinking about the sun's path, yeah? And its northern extent at the Tropic of Cancer, which we call Ke Alapolohiwa, Kane. So most of the northwestern Hawaiian Islands is within Poau, and this is a place of creation and origin for our people, but also where our ancestors return to after death. In the ao, which is south of Ke Alapolohiwa, Kane, or the Tropic of Cancer, this is where man resides. And so this is a very short explanation of our cosmology, but basically the whole entire archipelago represents the framework of our worldview, of representations of our perspectives about dualism and balance. And you can imagine this as in the east where the sun rises, yeah, and gives birth to life, and the islands are volcanically birthed from the oceanic womb, all the way to Holaniku in Kure, where the islands return to the sea and where the sun sets. So all of these things play into the worldview of Hawaiian existence. The Kumulipo is a creation chant with more than 2,000 lines that expresses this cosmology. And it begins with the birthing of a coral polyp. We acknowledge the coral polyp as our first ancestor, our first kupuna. And eventually, about 8 to 9 eras later, we have the birthing of the Hawaiian people themselves. So this tells us that we are people of place, we are born from this place, and this place is family, in essence. Which is why we refer to the northwestern Hawaiian islands as Kupuna Islands, ancestral grandparent islands. I'm gonna go over to these are some of the cultural sites that are located on Nihoa and Mokumanamana, the two immediate islands to the main Hawaiian islands. And these are very similar to other ceremonial and religious sites all over the world. This site in the two top pictures are on the island of Mokumanamana, which resides on the Tropic of Cancer. So you can imagine how much cultural significance and importance that place had for Hawaiians. So the vision is to forever protect and perpetuate ecosystem health and diversity and Native Hawaiian cultural significance of Papahānaumokuākea. The mission is to carry out seamless integrated management to ensure ecological integrity and achieve strong long-term protection and perpetuation of Northwestern Hawaiian Island ecosystems, Native Hawaiian culture, and heritage resources for current and future generations. The management structure is three-tiered, so we have at the top the three co-trustees. Basically, the state of Hawaii, the Department of Interior of the United States, and the Department of Commerce. The second tier is the senior executive board, so you have a designee from each of those three co-trustees, and they're represented by the Department of Land and Natural Resources, U.S. Fish and Wildlife, and NOAA. And then you have the Monument Management Board, which is really their kuleana, their responsibility is the daily management. So you have two sub-agencies from each of the co-trustees plus the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. And so just recently, many of you know that the Office of Hawaiian Affairs was actually elevated to a co-trustee. So now we have four co-trustees soon to be. So the Office of Hawaiian Affairs convenes the Native Hawaiian Cultural Working Group, which is the only consistent community component to our management. The Cultural Working Group includes nearly 50 Native Hawaiian cultural practitioners, researchers, natural resource managers, and advocates who inform and advise the Office of Hawaiian Affairs, including the co-managers, on the daily management. And they basically inform them about Native Hawaiian culture and history, of course, interests, to inform the management. The Native Hawaiian Cultural Working Group reviews all permit proposals. This is really important, all permit proposals, along with the 7 co-managing agencies, and provides questions and comments to the primary investigators as far as the cultural implications of their work. So part of the permit briefing that we have for every permitted individual includes a review of the conditions of their permit, a maritime heritage briefing, and a cultural briefing. And so part of the cultural briefing, the intent of this is to share, of course, about the cultural significance of Papahānaumokuākea and to communicate some of the cultural implications of their work, but also the cultural connections that their work has for us, yeah? Because when we think about this place, it's so culturally imbued, yeah, with meaning. But their research and their science, their projects give us a different perspective of who we are, yeah? We know that from our relation to other people, yeah? People teach us something about ourselves. So this has been really, really critical for us to make those partnerships between researchers and the Native Hawaiian community and practitioners of that expertise. One example is that cultural practitioners have been working with the Office of Hawaiian Affairs and the co-managing agencies and researchers to acquire seabird feathers, you see here, and basically to perform ceremony in the far left picture for our makahiki season, which is our annual kind of like Chinese New Year, but Hawaiian New Year, and these kahili, or royal feathered standards that are representative of our ancestral chiefs, of our chiefs. And the Culture Working Group also has a sub working group, which is called the Nomenclature Working Group. And they basically work with the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. And these are folks that are familiar or expert at Hawaiian language and Hawaiian traditional nomenclature. So they help to name new species, newly discovered species, or species that don't have widely known Hawaiian names. And these are some of the examples. But they go through a very traditional process, whether it be dreaming or looking at the characteristics of the creatures or the seaweed. In some cases, we just named 5 new seaweeds within the past year that were found at the mesophotic zone, which is basically 300 to I think about 500 meters. So they've been really, really successful at not only naming, but also building those relationships with the co-managers, with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, with fisheries, and of course us as a whole. So every year we create a permitted activities annual report, and this includes the summaries of all the permitted activities for the year, including statistics, like how many people went up there, how many people were on the island, how many fish were taken for research or for Hawaiian subsistence. But what we've noticed in our reports over the past 5 years is that there's been this real sincere effort to integrate. And you can see that, you know, we have a Hawaiian proverb on the front, beautiful pictures, but also, you know, people are curious about how their research can help to bring awareness in the Native Hawaiian community, but also what can the Native Hawaiian community bring to the researchers to help them enhance their research, yeah? And connect to them some of the gaps in their research. And we've done this very, very successfully. One of the permitted activities that is very, very important is, of course, long distance voyaging and wayfinding. This is the most unique and valuable traditional practice that Native Hawaiians have developed and continue to advance. This is an ancient way of interacting with the ocean and sky that continues to inspire and create social change. And this is exploration. This ocean region surrounding the northwestern Hawaiian islands is the only cultural voyaging seascape within the Hawaiian archipelago where marginal low-lying islands allow apprentice navigators to excel, yeah? Because when you're in the main Hawaiian islands, easy to see the next island, it's huge, yeah? But up in the northwestern Hawaiian islands, they're very, very marginal and low-lying. This year, the Polynesian Voyaging Society, and I'll go back a little bit, they teamed up with some of our researchers in the intertidal cruise for the first time and conducted research and monitoring. The picture that I wanted to show, and you saw it, but it's of Hikianalia and the searcher at Nihoa right here in the far left. It's kind of blurred, but they were up at Nihoa conducting this research and monitoring. And what we see is that, you know, the intertidal team includes researchers and managers and culture practitioners. But what's been really cool about it is that the culture practitioners have been really pivotal at collecting the data because they're familiar with scaling those really dangerous shorelines, yeah? And because they pick those opihi, they pick those limpets. And that's helped to enhance the data. Because some places are really, really inaccessible, yeah? One of the other things that we've been able to do is in partnership with Namaka o Papahānaumokuākea, which is a nonprofit group that started from a few that were inspired by their visit up to Papahānaumokuākea. They've been doing annual workshops with some of the managers up there. Because they're not able to be present there, they taught them traditional methodologies of observations and making connections, yeah? And they were able to develop this annual calendar of the seasons for Kure Atoll, Holaniku. And the methodology is called Huli'ia. So here we have all of the different observations and connections that were made both scientifically and traditionally. And so we connected that to Hawaiian proverbs and things that we knew were of baseline knowledge before, and to see how those things were different. But this is a great baseline moving forward when we're looking at huge changes, yeah, in our environment. And it's done very well. It's beautiful photos. And it's tiered in a way that, you know, recognizes the environment. And you have the skies, the Papahulileni, the Papahonua, the earth, and of course the Papahulihonua, the sacred space in the ocean. So our Moku Papapa Discovery Center is an interpretive center located in Hilo, Hawaii, where I'm from. Yeah, Hilo. And the Monument Education Program has worked with the Hawaiian language speakers to translate all of the displays and exhibits in Hawaiian language. The education program also seeks to develop culturally based activities and curriculum that promotes Native Hawaiian values and practices. And this all reinforces responsible stewardship of the environment. One thing I wanted to mention too is that even in our data integration program, they've been able to overlay some of the ancestral knowledge in a gridded format on the Northwestern Hawaiian Islands so that you would click the little grid, and anything that was related to research or any of our oral traditions can be populated in there. So it's an ongoing process to do this and keep it current. And then I also wanted to share with you that, you know, this place is such an incredible place, and it's very inspirational. And we at Papahānaumokuākea, all of the managers really strive to get that ike, that knowledge that allows us to effectively manage the place, yeah? Place-based management. And so one of the examples I just like to give is that when we do any staff meeting, we always start with Hawaiian protocol. And I tell you, you know, only a fraction of us are Hawaiian or even, you know, familiar with that kind of protocol, yeah? But everybody participates. They lend their clapping, they lend their voice, whatever it may be. And we're always trying to bring more to the table whenever we can, yeah? We have oli classes, we have chant classes, we have Hawaiian language classes, just to do that in-reach that is needed so that all of our managers, wherever they are, whether it's data management or the website or, you know, the researchers or policy and management or policy and programs, they can all see from a Hawaiian worldview and Hawaiian perspective how their work is relevant to place and how they can advocate for that integration. So I just wanted to leave you with this photo of our last year's intertidal monitoring cruise up at Mokumanamana. And just say mahalo for all of your support. And with the expansion, we also need an expanded support from all of the world. So mahalo for everything. So I think it's Atuatasi? Yes.
All right, there you go. Talofa. Ole, ale aise se ue tue langa vale. A wā wāla na mafua. Ua liwa foi foi le tau tai. A wā wā te tū liwa le tai. Ua matango fia le tātu wasu. Peo le fale na ia moa. E lau I ula ae pau I toa. Le tātu te whaftai e le tua o na ua tātu silfai. I luma o nuu ae leo tua nuu. I would simply say, welcome in and good morning. My talk will be on cultural importance in marine conservation. It's about understanding the past and moving forward with humility and respect. The National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa is co-managed with the local government of American Samoa and works closely with community adjacent to the sanctuary units in according to the Samoan cultural traditions and practices. This is a map of the sanctuary units in American Samoa. It shows the scale and distribution of the sites. We started in 1986 when our signature site, Whangatele Bay, was first established. It's about 0.25 square miles. And in the year 2012, we expanded six more sites with a total of 13,581 square miles. And we became the largest national marine sanctuary in the US system. Our Samoan culture has existed well over the past 3,000 years, emphasizing human connections to the sea as it is reflecting Samoan tradition and lifestyles. In managing marine sanctuaries, we have to make our culture the forefront in all we do. We have done this in several fronts in American Samoa. Our main goal is to making sanctuary relevant to place and people. Our visitor center is one of the only, it's the only visitor center south of the equator. The Papahānaumokuākea Marine National Monument has the Mokopapa Papa Discovery Center in Hilo. Having a center also allow us to have successful partnership with Google Street View, Catlin Sea View, Sean Michel Cousteau, Hoku Lea, the SSVC Seaman School of Oceanography, even our local hospital, our visitors bureau, and our federal partners like National Park Services of American Samoa. It also allows us to bridge opportunity with sanctuary communities, such as learning excursions, citizen science, outreach and education. Youth enrichment, we provide the youth with various programs that educate and promote ocean literacy by incorporating indigenous practices into modern forms of conservation. Our service have also increased to be a service provider in technical assistance, training on eco-tours, education, and outreach. We have a population of 57,000 people. Well, minus four, there's four of us attending the conference here this week. And our constituents reach has reached over 50,000 plus. 20% of those are tourists, 80% are local community. This is how powerful the Ocean Center mean to the local population. In our visitor centers, we have bilingual exhibits where the emphasis is serving our community first and foremost. In our tours, we use Samoan as our first language for student, community, and local tours. The top right is a Office of Samoan Affairs in-reach program with our National Marine Sanctuary. The bottom right is a photo of Ta'u, taken by XL Catlin Sea View Survey. It's one of the largest coral head in the world. It's over 500 years old, about three, four story tall. So protecting the importance of people and place that is uniquely Samoan have also been portrayed in films for the National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa. In the year 2013, we launched the film Penina Atuatasi America Samoa, a film that speaks about each of the special sanctuaries and their importance to American Samoa. We have several short films featuring cultural and people In 2014, Sean and Michelle Cousteau completed a documentary in where we told the story of Swains Island in film. This was awarded first prize in the Cultural Connection, People and the Sea category of the Blue Ocean Film Festival in St. Petersburg, Florida. All our films to date have been featured in film festivals across the US, and the Swains film was debuted at the Smithsonian 2 years ago. The message here is that film provides an important medium to share the stories of people, and having iconic personalities behind you to tell this is equally important. Our Ocean Center has been a mine for various forms, such as Koko Hangout with different island nations like Hawaii, Tahiti, American Samoa, just to name a few, preaching cultural and connection with places in the Pacific on common issues. In collaborations with Polynesian Voyage Society, the National Marine Sanctuary of American Samoa also hosted several Koko Hangouts, connecting teachers, connecting students, and connecting culture. Partnership is one of the critical part of our responsibility. And now it's not just about any partnership. We chose our partner based on our common interests and common understanding of respecting of our cultural, understanding our past, and be able to adapt to local and traditional values and practices. This is a picture of our tourist stakeholder from Australia and New Zealand who visit one of our sanctuary site. We also partner with National Park of American Samoa through interpretive training. As I mentioned earlier about Cuckoo Street View and XL Kalani Sea View, virtual type tours. And we also have a great relationship with Hawaiian Airline and some of our local hotels. Now, as I said, it's really critical that our partners are able to come to the table, not just to partake, but also share resources, share the costs, and be able to lend a hand whenever we need it. Last week, we celebrated the 100-year celebration of the National Park, and the National Marine Sanctuary play a major part in that celebration. Cultural and community engagement is another critical element of our work in American Samoa. Now, we have to keep in mind that there were or are people before the program became or took place. One of the challenges that we have as a program, and this is to gain the respect and trust of our community. And one thing that we go about doing this is through demonstrations, through the work that we bring to the community. Giving opportunities to all in American Samoa to learn about ASIC Success Sanctuary is done through eco tours. This allows our communities to experience and witness the beauty of these underwater areas with important place on keeping them healthy and vibrant for future generations. Oftentimes, we are struck with the fact that we are only there as conservation, but we had to find a balance between both conservation and economic development. Once you get the people, the community behind, gain your trust and support, I tell you, it does wonders in terms of our work, because it allows you to become part of the family. It allows you to do whatever is necessary that is important to their daily lives. It takes a long time. As I said, the expense, it took about 26 years. That didn't happen just overnight. That was through trust and for a persistent and perseverance. Oftentimes you had to factor in political will in your work. But the thing that you never walk away for if there's a problem, you need to be part of the solution. We have to remind ourselves of the reason why we're there in the first place. Now, it's not about acknowledgement, it's not about recognition, but it's about making a positive impact in people's life, reminding them the importance of place and people in our work. So one of the programs that we have within our program is Festival of Sites. We have over 14 cruise ships that comes in American Samoa. Our program is situated about a 5 minutes walk from the main dock. So as you know, these people are there for such a short period of time, and we manage to bring sanctuary sites, people and place to where tourists are at. Through performances, through art and crafts. We even have school kids who are adjacent to our sanctuary sites to come and perform on the behalf of their villages and demonstrating, gives them, make them feel important and appreciative because of showcasing their culture through dancing and songs and even doing demonstration weaving basket and so forth. The future of the program is our youth. We have several youth development programs throughout the year that engage the youth in marine science, cultural learning, as well as conservation. The top left picture shows the American students in Hawaii through an exchange program. We even have our Ocean Star students and ocean swimming, ocean science program. One is catered to, Ocean Star is catered to elementary level, and the ocean swimming, ocean science is catered to the high school. We even have youth fishing contests. You know, oftentimes we take it for granted. We're surrounded by ocean. a lot of these kids do not know how to swim. So again, part of the value added in the work we do is we provide swimming classes and making these people feel more comfortable and more engaged and connected to nature. So what is ahead of us? What is the future strategies for her? It's about making culture and place matter in our work. Projecting American Samoa to the outside world through films, through publications, through research, and through the work that we do in the Ocean Center. We currently have a UNESCO proposal as a World Heritage Site. Whangateles Sanctuary Site is currently on the listing of UNESCO site. But now with the expansion, we included the six additional sites and the Rose Atoll National Marine Sanctuary. This is done through consultation with our local government, with our leaders, to gain their support and blessing. And some of this is still in the work. While the application is being currently reviewed. So growing conservation science with acknowledgement of cultural practices and tradition is paramount in the work we do. Now, it's not about just being there to offer providing resources for research and also economic development. It's really about gaining trust and be able to adapt and building consensus among community in order to be accepted. Samoa has been around for many, many years, and their practice, there is a living culture as we speak. They've always been stewards of an environment, but finding that integrating the traditional knowledge and science is one of the key elements in the work that we do. But also, we have to remind ourselves the respect and the humility with all the work that we do. So that's what I have. I've taken your lover. Thank you for your attention, and look forward to your visit to American Samoa.
Go to Iorana korua, iorana korua. Tōku ingoa poko ki tāne hawa hei. Au ioho mai ai, mai rapa nui. Ioho mai ai, mhaka mana uatu, mhaka ite atu. I tō oku manau, i tō oku hinua, i tō oku hanga, ki tō oku, ki tō tangata. Aloha kakou, and mahalo everyone to be here. I apologize, for me it's a little complicated. English is not my mother language, including the Spanish. So sometimes I can translate and lose the feeling that comes from my mother language. I feel concepts and words are lost in each translations. My name is Poky Tane Hawahei. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here in Hawaii again. This is my third time here. And I always remember the first time I was, when all asked me where I come from. And I say, Rapa Nui. And many people don't know where is that. Never mind, even in my country happened. I was thinking about how isolated we are by geography and even by the Spanish language. But in this third opportunity, I feel the value of this big networking and how can we push together side by side. My home motherland is Rapa Nui. Rapa Nui is an island in the Pacific Ocean. It is in the eastern corner of the Polynesian Triangle. The most of people worldwide know my island like Easter Island. And it is famous for our big stone sculpture called Moai. For my ancestors, the Moai's name is Aringaora o Te Tupuna. And that means the face alive of my ancestor. I think we are the most isolated island in the Pacific. And people know the status pictures. But when you will see the Moai and the pictures, you can think that my ancestor has said, the Moai are alive. Because my people and the Moai are one. Living as a people, my culture is alive. The Moai language is alive. We're still alive and will not disappear. I always remember my history and heritage by my grandfather. When we sat around the campfire at night, he told me the stories of my ancestors come from his grandfather and behind. He told me when the great spirit called Uoke raised his spear and creating the lands growing from the undersea, every people on the big oceans, the Moana Nui Akiva, received a piece of the sky. Every people receive a piece of wind. Every people receive a piece of land. Every people receive a piece of sea. And my people receive Rapa Nui. All received was tied and bound in a unique and indivisible union and trusted in a mission of protection. This union, know it by my people as mana, tapu, moa, and refer about the respect of being, respect of life. For my people, this rope join all in one concept, and the concept is Rapa Nui. It is why my people know segregated and understood our land, our seed, our sea, our animals, and our people as the same thing. We are the respect, we are the protectors, we are the protector of Rapa Nui, and we are the keepers of the balance. We are all a part of this world, and the networking is so important to join it all, but we know the particular needs for our island. My grandfather say me, we cannot separate the shark from the sea, like the Rapa Nui people can't separate it from their habitats. Through the Treaty of Wilds of September 9, 1888, between the King Atamu Tekena representing the Rapa Nui families and the Navy Captain Policarpo Toro representing the Chilean government, sovereigning has remained. We work with the Chilean government to remember this treaty. From 1966, we have our Chilean rights. From 1976, we are a nature sanctuary in the Chilean system. In the 2000, we are declared, was declared park, submarinos, coral nui nui, motu tautara, and hangauteo. In the 2010, was declared our marine national park, motu matiro hiva. But they take decision without us, and no question about our rights. We are not a spectator, we are the nature, and we still believe in our connection. We don't have a big boat, and we can say today to them, how can we walk together? I work to remember to the Chilean government and all the NGOs, we are alive, and we still believe in Rapa Nui. Maururu, thank you. Mahalo.
Thank you very much, Poky. English may not be your mother language or your first or second, even third language, but I think your message came very loud and clear. We have about 7 minutes. I'm hoping that we have some questions for our panelists. Questions, anybody? Well, maybe I'll start off for the three sites represented. Two of you are currently World Heritage Sites, and one I think hopes to be a World Heritage Site. So I'm curious if perhaps you can tell us a bit about how that designation has assisted you, particularly in your efforts to better integrate natural and cultural heritage. Anyone want to take that on?
Efectivamente, hemos recibido beneficios tanto del sector turístico en cuanto al crecimiento socioeconómico. Sin embargo, nosotros como pueblo estamos apuntando más hacia una calidad de vida más que hacia el crecimiento económico. De verdad, pensamos que a veces el crecimiento socioeconómico tiene que encontrar un balance y ese balance tiene que ser no perder nuestra conexión con lo que nosotros somos, no que perder la conexión con nuestra madre y no perder nuestra conexión con nuestros ancestros.
He sees the benefit, like, you know, now the island is better known around the world, so there's an increase in tourism, which actually bring economic benefit to the island. But he said that we are not looking for economic benefit, we are looking for quality of life. And the economic benefit has a limit. But we are looking for a balance, and you know, we are looking how we connect our people with our land, with our resources, with our culture. It's true, there is economic benefits, but it's not the only thing we are looking for.
Sure. I think that the World Heritage inscription was part of our story and did bring some other things to the table, but I think that for Papahānaumokuākea, it brought an awareness for Native Hawaiian people. First and foremost, I'd like to mention that. because we were coming out of Hawaiian Renaissance and into a resurgence of our culture where we weren't fighting to get into the building to say we should be part of the conversation. We were at the table making decisions, and that's the difference between Papahānaumokuākea. I also think that for global issues like marine debris and for our albatross being victimized or being victim to that, and for all kinds of things, climate change, coral bleaching, and being the largest, there's a lot of, we get a lot of headliners, yeah. So it helps to bring that message about place and the impact that we are inflicting on the environment. Even in the remote places of the world, things are happening. So I think that the World Heritage Inscription helped us to tell that story, definitely. But there has been a tremendous revival in the Native Hawaiian community as far as connection to culture and revitalization.
American Samoa is currently under consideration as a World Heritage. And this was not prompted because of economic reasons. We took this upon ourselves and the community. It's our responsibility to Mother Nature. This is a reminder to us as stewards of the planet Earth, as caretaker. So this is our gift for the future generation. It didn't just happen overnight. This has required a lot of research and consultation with our local stakeholders, political leaders. And it really, as I said, this is it's part of our responsibility to make sure that we safeguard nature for future generations.
Great, thank you so much. I think we need to wrap up just about, our time is just about over. But let's give one more round of applause for our panelists.